years in a row, and I also really excited to be featured in the Forbes magazine at one of Calgary's top 30 commercial brands tomorrow. You can find all the Topper products in over 60 retailers in Calgary. We started in the food service industry and then quickly grew into the organic grocery stores in Calgary by our friends at Community National Foods, which was really good in building up local support and a solid reputation. But from the very beginning, I wanted Little Topper to be easily accessible for people, which is why I'm now concentrating on growing the business into mainstream conventional grocery. We'll be launching with Smoothie Safeway by the end of July, and we're also expanding into the BC market at the same time. So we're aiming to have 150 retailers nationwide by the end of the year. Little Topper targets busy females between the ages of 26 to 40 years old, like Sally. Sally is a busy mom of two. She chooses quality over price, and she loves feeding her kids healthy snacks in between rushing them from school and summer practice. You see, we are in the middle of a clean label food revolution. More and more consumers, like Sally, are picking up packages and wanting to see ingredients that they recognize. So this is exactly what Little Topper is. On your chair, you have a sample of our salty caramel energy bites, and on the left are the simple ingredients that we put into it. Now let's compare this to one of the most well-known healthy snack brands in Canada. Our competitors are using ingredients like this, and they're telling you that it's good for you. You see, Little Topper has a philosophy that if you can't pronounce it, you won't find it in our products. And luckily, there are some new brands out there that carry the same philosophy. And they've created products that are so simple that they only have two ingredients in them. And personally, I think this is great, and it's definitely a step in the right direction. However, I want to take this further and make something more substantial for you. So I took this simple ingredient deck and I added exotic superfoods that aren't really being used in the mainstream market. I concentrated on superfoods that are especially benefit females, such as baccarat, which balances hormones and increases fertility. So not only are you getting something that's delicious for you, but it's also really good for your mind. A lot of you saw my Pinterest district mentions last November, so I just thought I'd update you what we've been up to over the past 6 months. So on top of our investment and partnership with Arlene, we've also been working really hard with developing new packaging to make sure that we can really stand out in a competitive landscape, and this will be ready to launch within the next month. We now have a confirmed stable shelf life of 6 months. We've built up a really solid team of six strong, passionate females, and we're currently transitioning our production from Calgary to a co-packer in Vancouver to make sure that we can keep up with demand and to increase our capacity tenfold. So as we reach our teenagers, we're a little more support within the company. So we've just signed on with Nationwide Growth and the law itself to help with our sales, but I'm also looking for support when it comes to distribution to help with the logistics of this. So I'd really like to work with a distributor that has a nationwide reach and a really strong hold on the mainstream grocery industry. And also, midway through next year, I'll be looking to do my second raise to help support growth across Canada and into the US market. So I know that the name insinuates that I'm little, and I might be little, but I can promise you that I have big plans when it comes to making a real difference in the better things.
Okay, so sorry for making you guys watch it again.
No, it was late the first time.
So I use that as an example because I think Laura really nailed her presentation. Things that I'd be curious to kind of hear again, kind of what you guys think about it, but things that really stood out to me, she had really kind of clean slides. So not a lot of text, not a ton of imagery, not a lot going on, very clean, which allowed people to focus their attention on her and the story that she was telling. The imagery and the words and everything else that she had on her slides were just there really to emphasize key points that she was making through her storytelling. So I think that's really important. It's really easy to get lost in your slide deck, but less is almost always more when it comes to PowerPoint decks. Also, you'll probably notice like throughout her presentation, like she spent a lot of time really focusing on brand development, which is really important in CPG. I would argue that it's also really important in services companies and technology companies. So, you know, think about your brand, think about what you stand for, and, you know, know, what's the common story that you would tell someone about if you were talking to a friend at a dinner party versus talking to a corporate executive versus talking to someone at IBM? You know, where are those commonalities? What are the really kind of core elements of your brand, of your company? You know, what are those consistent colors, right? So trying to keep color schemes kind of plain for the most part is great. For example, like District Ventures and IBM, our colors are like just turquoise and gray color. We try to keep some consistency in that across everything that we do. The benefit of that is that somebody can walk in partway through a presentation and they'll be like, oh, that's obviously like a District Ventures corporate slide deck. You can tell right away by the colors. Big brands do that all the time, right? They have, like, you take a look at something, you don't even need to see their name to know that it's their brand. Same with, like, the language that you use, right? If there's a lot of kind of common language that you use on your website and everything, make sure that that's reflected in your speech and on your slides, and to just kind of reinforce those key messages. And something that I mentioned last week. So one of our media planners upstairs, he sent around a really interesting article a few months back, and it was around banner ads on websites. So oftentimes people, or at least in the past, they used to do banner ads with lots of text on them. But they've found that people tend to only look at a banner ad for 1 second. And humans are only able to read about 10 words in 1 second, or process 10 words in 1 second. So on a banner ad, you never want to have more than 10 words, because that's all that people are going to be able to take in when they're looking, when they glance over at it. I would argue kind of a similar thing with slides. You're going to get a little bit more of their attention, but in any kind of one point, like any one line or, you know, overall on a slide, you don't want to have a lot of text, because they're going to be watching you, they're going to glance over, and then they ideally should glance back to you. So you want to kind of think of your slide deck as kind of that banner ad that's like changing every 30 seconds, right? So try to keep this text really minimal so that it reinforces the really important points that you're making, but then allows them to kind of refocus their attention back on you. In most cases, companies will actually have kind of two versions of the same slide deck. You'll have the one that you present, and then if you have a copy that you are going to then send out by email to, say, investors, you would have one with more text on it. So you would basically take, you know, kind of the empty slides that you have plus the script that you've written for yourself, and you would kind of create a hybrid version. Side tangent to that, if you ever are trying to get a meeting with a VC and they say just send over your slide deck, don't do that. You probably won't get the meeting with them.
It's a way to get rid of you.
Yeah. It's a way to get rid of you, because then they have the opportunity to find holes in your story before they've even had a chance to talk to you.
What are they
going to
tell from a slide deck?
Well, and then you could put your full business plan in it, but really you've got nothing to win from that in most cases. Some cases it'll turn out well, but I would typically always push to have the meeting before I send over any material.
They're foolish to request that as well, instead of an in-person meeting, because it ends up being a junior analyst who doesn't know their bottom from page 8, and then they lose the deal.
Exactly.
So Mark and I have been retained by a few VC funds to go and bird dog and do the technical due diligence on that stuff.
Yeah.
For, you know, companies they're trying to invest in.
Yeah. So don't send your have your presentation slide deck, have your VC slide deck, but don't send your VC slide deck to people without a meeting. It should come, like, after. So ideally, you would go into a meeting with your, like, pitch deck, and then after the meeting, or you would have a paper copy that you would hand them.
We learned a long time ago, when somebody says, send me your fee schedule, you never...
Oh, yeah, no.
Send your fee schedule. What are they going to do with it?
What I've said
for years is they're going to compare you against a professor who charges $500 a day.
Yeah.
What's it going to do? Well, there's no value. You've created no, just, you know, it's zero, so we never, ever,